Bob Dylan famously sang, "These times are changing." This episode of Meet the Brewer was recorded on the 19th of June and featured Bridger from Western Herd. It was recorded live in front of friends and customers in the Hop Garden, which is on Back Lane, a closed street adjacent to Mother Max. There were some technical difficulties. There were some walkthroughs. There were some randomers, including Mr. Steve Kinnean from 3D City. We hope you appreciate the effort that went into this. Not as refined as some of the others, but it was great fun and good crack. I think the energy that was brought, and you could hear the laughter in the background for a lot of this, you know, displays how much the Irish pub and the traditional pub have to do with our sense of community, fun and spirit. I hope you enjoy the episode.
Welcome to Meet the Brewer, live from the Back Lane on the side of Mother Max, here with a shower of absolute lunatics who are sitting out on the road, drinking Western Herd beer, looking to talk to Bridger. It's probably going to be one of the quicker Meet the Brewers because we are exceptionally busy here tonight. And I said I'd do this without actually knowing how busy we were going to be. And it's a bit of crack, and we said we'd keep going. So just thanks to everyone who joined us. Thanks to everyone who bought the beer. Thanks to everyone who's sitting around here. I'm drinking the whiskey stout, or the stout conditioned in the whiskey bar. So it's quite delicious. But look, maybe I'm going to just push it straight over to you, Bridger. And I'm going to say, maybe tell us a little bit about yourself, Western Herd, and maybe the beers that you have and how you became a brewer, maybe. Let's kick it off that way.
Yeah, no, that sounds good. My name is Bridger Kelleher. I'm the head brewer at Western Herd. We are based in Kilmaley, which is just outside of Ennis. We've been open for this going on 6 years. And I've been a brewer there now for almost 3 years. So basically when I ended up moving over to Ireland, my wife's from County Clare. So that's kind of what brought me over. And then I'd been actually working in construction before when I was in the States. I'm from Montana in the States. But I'd always been home brewing. And then I'd had a lot of friends in the industry, almost jumped over, had a few job interviews, a good few times actually almost jumped over, but it just didn't work out. It wasn't the right fit. So I kind of viewed moving to Ireland as a chance at getting out of construction and being able to, actually do what I've always wanted to do, which is brew. So, it worked out really well. They just happened at the time in Western Herd to be looking for another hand to come on. So I was there for almost 2 years. And then about a year ago, they made me the head brewer there. So, it's been a good ride. Anyway, the owners of Western Herd also own McHugh's in Ennis. I don't know if anybody's ever been in there, and Flanagan's out in the Hinch. So that'd be kind of like, you know, so quote unquote, our tap rooms. They do good food out there as well.
My in-laws love to go to McHugh's for the chicken wings.
Very good. They're savage. They're really good there. Yeah. That's one of my favorite things on the menu myself.
Yeah. So that's a good night out when we go to chicken wings and a few pints.
Yeah. Very good. We do about, this stage, we probably do about 15. We have about 15 different beers we brew. They're not obviously all on at the same time. Kind of, we have a few seasonal ones, and then, you know, like the summertime, we like to have some of these like New England IPAs and pale ales, like the La Hinch pale ale, which some of you might be drinking there now. It's what I'm drinking here tonight, actually. And then obviously in the wintertime, we like to do a few seasonals, like the Imperial Stouts, the Porter, the Atlantic Red Ale. Basically, we used to have about 75 to 90% of our beer, our stock was moved through draft lines, mostly in Clare. You know, the different times we'd have taps set up in, you know, down in Limerick or Galway or even over in Dublin, but mostly in Clare. Obviously then with COVID, it kind of pushed us to look at other options. And one of those was canning, obviously. So it was something to do anyways. And it kind of forced our hand on the matter, which was, I think, very good. A lot of breweries kind of was the same thing that they were facing. So it kind of just, I suppose forced us to diversify, but it also kind of brought us to some markets that we weren't used to being in. Kind of got a bit more maybe exposure to kind of what we were doing out in Western Herd. So it's been good that way. Now, obviously, with places kind of starting to open back up, thank goodness, we've started obviously doing a lot more kegs again, which has been great as well. It's been good to kind of get back and down and out and seeing some of these places that we've kind of missed. So no, it's been great to kind of have a few keg accounts going. It's made things a bit more exciting. Obviously, we use a mobile canning line, which a lot of places do nowadays. So they're based in Mullingar. They come out 1 or 2 days at a time, and they can empty basically all of our tanks in 2 days. And on the old bottling line and kegging, that used to take me about 3 weeks to do. So it's a big difference. It's kind of really led to a big uptick in production. We've always kind of figured that the brewery has a capacity, if we scheduled everything right, to do about 100,000 liters. We've only been kind of averaging pre-COVID maybe 30 to 40,000 liters, just based off of how long it would take us to package kegging and things like that. So actually, we're on pace at the moment to do about twice as much beer as we've ever done this year. We're also expanding at the moment. So we have a new building basically off of the existing brewery, where we're going to be moving the hot deck, which is the mash tun, the kettle, and the hot liquor tank. We're going to move that out into the new building and be able to bring in about 10,000 more liters worth of fermenting and bright tank capacity.
So do you know what's really interesting, Bridger, right? Because I think this is the ninth. And the previous 8 brewers and breweries have all discussed expansion, growth, and reinvestment throughout COVID-19. Isn't it amazing, right, that you'd say you've lost such a high percentage of your draft beer off of the counter, and you've had to refocus and pivot almost, and that's led to new buildings, new equipment, new beers, new canning lines, new canning machines. And that's Vincent Galluli. Say hello, Vincent.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, I suppose throughout COVID, what has driven you on to for the expansion?
So it's just been really like, we feel like we're on the pace to kind of max out our capacity. And it kind of in that, we also have a bit more, you know, being that the canning line is coming in and able to package so much volume at a time, it's taking a bit of the pressure off our packaging side of things. So it's kind of led to nearly, I wouldn't say a bit of downtime, but you know what I mean? Like we've seen that the potential is definitely there for us to be able to produce more, brew more, like brew more days, and be able to have more product available. So, but like you said, actually, like everybody I talked to nearly in the industry has kind of echoed that statement of, you know, it's obviously tough times for a lot of people, tough times even for us at times with COVID and everything like that. But at the same time, it's led to a real, I suppose, maybe kind of, it's really pushed a lot of these breweries to maybe reach out into different areas, branch out that they maybe were hesitant to do before. But now that they're doing it, it's been great, and they've kind of seen the benefits of that. Yeah, I know, like the Dead Center, obviously building a big massive brewery that they're going to be moving into soon. Yeah, like you said, it seems like everybody's kind of had an uptick in production, which is great. I don't see personally maybe as much draft going back to how it used to be. I feel like maybe the big dogs like Guinness and Heineken are going to be really poised to, hold on to everything they can, which is kind of they really kind of, I'd say from their perspective, they kind of need, the majority of these pub lines back. And so they're going to be more maybe cutthroat than ever. And it's not often like you have like a pub, especially here in Clare, have a pub kind of that that's willing to take on craft beer, like especially like some, you know, you guys and, you think of some of the pubs up in Galway and things like that. But so personally, I'd like to obviously continue doing, you know, a handful of kegs. we'd obviously be doing our own two pubs with everything we kind of brew, because we'll have kegs, we'll have available stock, of course. And then just really working with the ones that kind of, wanted us before all this as well. Like, we'd be on the road a lot, you know, really pushing for these, working hard, trying to set up new draft accounts before, with nothing to show for it a lot of the time. So I personally don't envision maybe us maybe putting as much effort into chasing down these rural pubs that really, I suppose, at the end of the day, wouldn't really be too interested in the local beer, because, you know, the benefits that they might be able to get from a company with larger resources. But then at the same time, the ones that we've dealt with, like you guys and other pubs that obviously have that great reputation within the industry, like we're excited to kind of see where things go there.
No, and it's really interesting actually to watch what's going on, because I mean we'd Mark and Vivian from Lyme and on, they had just kicked things off when COVID-19 had just kicked in, and you know we had Carla and Sean White Street. Then you had Declan from Otter Bank. Like just of those three, like they all just kind of really kicked off pre-COVID, and it's kind of, you know, they didn't really get a chance to go and operate properly and do what they were going to do, but they still managed to make a good show of it. Can I ask, right? You operate two pubs in conjunction with the brewery. What's the benefit to you? I mean, from that respect, like, I mean, can you try out new things? Can you try the experimental range? Can you just gauge, I suppose, customer feedback from that, or what's the benefit?
Yeah, definitely. Like, we've got I'm up any day that I'm not necessarily brewing at the brewery, this kind of gives me an opportunity to even do some of the stuff on our pilot system, which basically is a glorified homebrew kit. To be honest, I, you know, brew 20 liters at a time if I want on some of the smaller system there, try out new recipes, work on recipes that may eventually make it to the big system, or stuff that I've even just always kind of wanted to mess around with. And then I have an avenue there that I can, you know, kick it to McHugh's. Most of the time it's McHugh's, Flanagan's has less taps available. McHugh's, we've got 9 taps there that we have for our stuff. So that kind of has a bit more flexibility with being able to put on, you know, a keg of some dry hopped Pilsner that I want to, you know, want to mess around with or something like that.
It's really interesting here this evening, right? Because we're sitting down and we kind of have like this kind of artisan beer this side, artisan beer that side, and wedge in the middle, then we have Heineken, right? Which is great, right? And don't get me wrong, it's a good beer in its own right, right? But I mean, if we were open and operating as normal, you know, when people come in, one of the things they'd often ask us is, can we try something new or what's different or anything? And that's why the guys are here, right? Because they love all this kind of stuff, right? But I mean, if I was to say to the guys, instead of getting Heineken now, what would you go with? What would you recommend from your range?
From our range, maybe what's there, I'd say give the Lahinch Pale Ale a shot.
Yeah.
If it's something that they're walking into the off license, you know, if James's place up there on Roches Street, I'd say look at the Loophead Pilsner. That's one of my favorite beers the last little bit that we've been able to put out. Loophead has been, I'd say this time next year, Loophead Pilsner is going to be the biggest beer that we do. You know, we're adding on 10,000 liters of production to the brewery at our place. I'd say 8,000 liters of that is going to be Loophead Pilsner all the time. If we do pursue new lines, draft lines in Clare, in these rural pubs, Loophead's going to be that beer that's going to be, that's going to kind of be the one that gets our foot in the door in a lot of these places.
Yeah, actually, I've had the Loophead. The Loophead is quite good. You know, we've been pouring 3 beers from you. Obviously, I've just demolished the stout, right? That's gone. So that was 9.5%, right? Absolute beauty. Beautiful, beautiful whiskey flavor to it, right? I have to say, it's quite delicious. Lovely in chocolate, right? It's lovely, kind of a dark chocolate kind of tartness just mixed with that whiskey, right? And it was conditioned. I suppose, will I say conditioned or finished? Which is the correct term?
So it was finished. So basically, I brew that beer over the wintertime with the idea of that I'd kind of talk to a few of these independent bottlers and look at something for a cask finish on this beer. And actually, it was exciting because I was able to kind of do two different things. I talked to Nick at Thomengate. He ended up sending me, I don't know if you guys have had some of Nick's whiskey there, but he had a cognac cask finish whiskey last year that he released kind of around Christmas time.
Yeah.
The brilliant, brilliant whiskey. But so anyway, he sent me that cognac cask. So I filled that full of the Imperial Stout that's on there tonight. And then with what I had left, I actually was able to get a cask off Doughty O'Connell from W.D. O'Connell Whiskey. So I've actually got that aging at the moment at the brewery. So it'll be interesting to kind of compare, you know, maybe what the beer was like. I think Rob's actually had, if I'm not mistaken, Rob, were you on that, Rob, the Ella Mulligan tasting? Rob at home there. But anyway, so we tried the beer. We actually had samples of the bottles of the beer that we sent out. It was the unaged version of this Imperial Stout. So then I also have, obviously, the cognac cask version with Nick at Thomengate. And then we have the version that's actually aging at the moment, which is a double distilled Irish whiskey stout or Irish whiskey cask from Doughty O'Connell there at W.D. O'Connell, who's, you know, I don't know, maybe some of you have tried the Bill Phil whiskey or some of his whiskeys, but he's doing some exciting things kind of in the whiskey industry at the moment as well.
So I'm going to just turn the camera, right? Because like we're in the middle of madness here tonight, right? So I don't know, can you see that? So we're actually on the road, right? This is lunacy, right? So we've the road closed down here. This is the weirdest thing I think we've ever done, right? I'm going to turn it down, right? Because like if we look in, that's your man's bedroom over there, right? We shouldn't be looking in there, right? Look, actually, close the curtains just in case. Oh, we'll get ourselves in so much trouble. Okay. We didn't really think this one through, right? So you know what, right? It's absolutely fantastic. So as again, someone commented today, right, that it was really, really unusual that you had a Limerick and Clare people working together to create a single entity, i.e. this beer, right? And I suppose I had to say no, but sure, look, obviously Bridger is neither from Limerick or Clare, so he's completely he's like the UN, right? He's brokered peace and he's doing it. But look, it's a really fantastic beer, right? 9.5%. It is abuse. I mean, are there plans to do more like it? I know you mentioned Doughty O'Connell's cask, but I mean, is this something like we're going to see? Like, was it Dahlman that we had maybe 2 years ago, or was it 2.5 years ago? Is this something that's going to find its way into can or bottle?
Yeah. So basically, what I have left of this beer, I've got, you know, a couple hundred liters left of this beer. I'd say probably about 300 liters left of it. That's all going to go into bottles. And what I'm going to do with that at the moment is James is going to get some out on Rocha Street there at Fine Wines. He's probably, when it's only off, he's just going to get some of it. But we're going to sell most of it through our web shop. And that's kind of, I suppose, what it's obviously smaller batch stuff, but you know, some of the breweries today, like you'd see maybe doing collabs and barrel swapping with like the likes of like Teelings or Jameson or, you know, some of these big whiskey producers. Kind of where I see our niche in the market is maybe with some of these independent small batch kind of whiskey producers. So, you know, we've obviously, like with Dahlman, we've done a lot of stuff with JJ Corey out here in Clare. I mean, they're about 20 minutes down the road. So it's easy kind of to do last minute kind of collabs with them. Most of the time it is last minute because of the way that we both organize things. But it is going to be something I'd like to keep doing. You know, actually, Nick's in the process of sending me another cask that I'm going to put our red ale into for a little while. So it'll be kind of interesting to see how that pans out. I've got a barley wine that I'm actually going to be getting a peated cask off of Doughty O'Connell from, hopefully in the near future. And I'll be aging that barley wine in that peated cask. I could see this kind of barreling process going down the road of, them being, most of it being into bottles, most of it being available through the web shop, you know, the odd keg here or there. Actually, you guys, that keg, actually, you guys have probably be the only time that'll be on draft, that one. But definitely, definitely, like, I like the kind of the small little, small batch collabs that these, kind of fun to play around with different barrels and, you know, different finishes on some of these beers.
Yeah, and the beer, like, the beer has sold really well this weekend. Like, I mean, that, like, considering it went on yesterday morning, the Imperial Stout is pretty much gone. You know, it's between, well, look, there was a fair chunk of it drank last night, and a few sore heads this morning after it. But I mean, it's gone out in growler as well. I think of the two others, that are, I suppose, more well known, i.e. the Lahinch and the Cliff Road, the Lahinch has probably gone that little bit better. You know, I don't know why, I prefer the Cliff Road myself. I think the Lahinch is safer, and I think you alluded to that earlier on in terms of you swap your Heineken for that, you know. But yeah, look, they've gone really well. I suppose, can I ask, just we kind of fluffed over your story a little bit, right? So you said you were in construction, you moved to Clare with your wife. How did you actually start brewing? Could you skip that part?
So for what is it now? Probably eight or 9 years. Before this, I was doing homebrew. So basically, it was just when I was back in the States, I was doing homebrew, working through. You know, obviously, even started with kind of the kits. You know, the extract brewing, kind of made my way to all grain brewing. And then, you know, kind of from there, I was, you know, moved on. Then anybody who's homebrewed has moved on from, like, maybe bottling everything to kegging things and, you know, having their own draft lines at the house and things like that. So it kind of just worked out then. You know, I had a lot of friends in the industry, so I was familiar with, you know, obviously the brewing process, even on a large scale. I'd often, you know, brewing craft beer is like just a massive thing in the States. Like within an hour's drive of my house that I lived at in Montana there, it was about hour's drive. There was 19 different craft breweries that, you know, all had tap rooms. You can go in and a few pints. So, it was just massive. It was kind of one of my favorite things about the area. You know, you go and it's a really tight knit community too. Like you go into a craft brewery and like nearly the first thing they'll ask someone maybe just visiting is, what other breweries have you been to? And then it'd be followed by like, oh, after you're done here, you should go see this place and this place. They do good stuff. Go to this brewery. Like,
I'm gonna stop you, right? Because you're avoiding the question a little bit. How did you start brewing in Western Herd? Go on, tell us.
Western Herd specifically. Okay.
Why are you avoiding it?
Western Herd specifically. I was taking it as from the start anyway. But at Western Herd specifically, literally, I just showed up one day not long after I'd moved. Ian Gary was the name of the last brewer there. I just showed up, said, would you be looking for, you know, part-time, full-time help? I said, whatever you're looking for, I'd be happy to jump in. That went on from going into McHugh's a few times and meeting Mick and Maeve, two owners, having a few pints in there. That led into basically just going in and helping out on a few bottling runs. I think the first day that I was ever there in Kilmaley at the brewery, I think I was basically just running the labeler, putting labels on bottles for Night Pod, which was a vanilla porter. And then basically went from that. I remember, I think that was kind of around November, like that January, they called and said, okay, like, will you come in full time?
Yeah.
We're going to start, you know, trying to up production this year. So went in full time, obviously small brewery. There was two of us out there. You know, if you're there, you're going to be helping with packaging, you're going to be helping with brewing, you're going to be helping with, you know, cellaring, all the stuff. So basically, from that point on, it was just kind of a bit of baptism by fire, learning on the job. Sure, just that's kind of, I suppose, led to where it's at now. Is just learning on the job, and
you just scared off two of the Heineken drinkers. That's okay. No, they have to go. They told me that before they started. You didn't really scare them. Okay. No, look, it's a lovely story, right? Because Cora, my partner, my missus, would say when we did the homebrew challenge, Cora would have passed by, and she'd been in the brewery once or twice to collect kegs, even, I think, and drop back empties, because she's living not too far from there. But then you were very good to help us out with the staff homebrew challenge. And I mean, she brewed a beautiful, beautiful red ale. It was actually quite delicious. And interestingly enough, we all brewed kind of maybe 10 or 15 litres. She brewed 50 litres. I don't know, does that say more about her or ye? But she went big, like, and we were drinking red ale for quite a while afterwards. But yeah, it was really good, you know. And I just want to say thank you for participating in that with us, you know, and just taking the time to spend with Cora just to teach her how to brew. Because for the guys here, like, we all the staff learned how to brew beer, homebrew beer, yeah, during lockdown. And it was quite fun. It was actually quite interesting. There was some really good beer.
That was like a great idea at the time, like, because I mean, you know, it was probably, you know, I'd imagine you guys might have been just thinking, what are we going to do at this time, like, what are we going to do, you know, to keep ourselves busy. Even it was great, it was actually great idea to kind of get everybody involved, get the breweries involved in with you guys as well. I actually, one of my questions is, how many hydrometers do you think you guys went through, and how many were dropped and broken?
Me
over the course of the whole,
me personally or the group?
So as a group, I'd say the over under would probably be about 10.
So I have never shared this with anyone. I bought 20 hydrometers, right? Yeah, I bought 20 hydrometers, right? And I broke two just unpacking the box. Right, so you know, and we got all our stuff from Get Her Brewed, right? And I actually sent Get Her Brewed a picture and an email given out, because it wasn't my fault, right? It really wasn't. The bottom fell off of the tube, right? So I'm totally putting them back to them now. And in fairness, they were very good. They sent me two extra. But look, I think we probably broke all of the 20, I would say, because I remember ordering more. And probably the most interesting story, and I'm gonna get shot for telling this story. While Cora was brewing, she didn't break her hydrometer. Her mother broke her hydrometer. She knocked it off the kitchen table. And saying nothing, she picked it up, put a bit of sellotape around it, and handed it back to her. So obviously the hydrometer won't work. But Cora couldn't tell her mother, like, that it's not going to work. So she pretended to do what she was doing with the hydrometer. So when we were talking about it afterwards, we said, Joan, where do you think ABV-wise, where do you think the beer is going to be, or what do you think it's going to be? She said, I haven't a clue, because I wasn't even able to take a reading. So her beer was totally unknown. Like, it was just, we were not sure. But I just want to touch back there, because all of the staff did really well, right, with the exception of Vinnie Galooey. Right, and I do give him a bit of a hard time, but I'm really going to give him an even harder time now, because one of the next Meet the Brewers, I think next Meet the Brewers is Rascals. The one after that is the Open Gate Brewery, right? The Open Gate Brewery sent Vinny the Rolls Royce of hops, of malt, of equipment, right? They actually gave him the Brewer's personal number to ring day or night, right? So when Vinny was brewing, it was a Sunday afternoon, he was brewing. The brewer, John, I can't remember his second name, was having dinner with his mother, right, while talking to Vinny on the phone and explaining to him how to brew, right? So of any of us that had the best chance of getting a good beer, it was Vinny, right? And he fucked it up, right? He created colored water. And it's the only way of explaining it. Now, he was quite disappointed about it, right? We wanted him to try a second brew, but he's disheartened. So he's decided he's never going to brew, right? But it was only this week he said that he may take a trip out to Ennis to McHugh's, and he reckons that you'll bring him out to the brewery to brew your next batch with you. Are you willing to put it in his hands?
Absolutely. Anytime. I don't even have glass hydrometers, so I wouldn't be worried about that. Anytime he wants to come out and be on a brew day, that sounds good to me anyway.
Oh, you're going to regret that, yeah? There's nervous laughs here, right? Barry Kennedy is saying we're going to strap a GoPro onto him. I don't know if we need to strap more onto him than that. Yeah, a saddle, yeah. Okay.
Can you put a content warning on your hands?
I can't. Jesus Christ. So I'm going to say, right, so they probably can't hear what's going on, right? So what there's the whole heap of stuff going on here, right? So they're it's all about Vinny-isms and what they're going to do to Vinny. So they're saying that they're wondering, can you put a content warning on the label saying brewed by Vinny Galooly, you know, just in case, right? So interestingly, Bridger, right? I'm going to say we asked Opengate the same question just before Christmas, right? They said they had to get on to health and safety to see what the story was. They haven't rang us back, right? So they're just avoiding the question now. Okay, look, let's talk about the beers you're pouring tonight, right? So you have a beautiful Hinch pale ale. You have a lovely Cliff Road, and I really, really like the Cliff Road. Maybe tell us a bit about those two.
Okay, so the Hinch pale, this is just the second time we brewed this one. We'll be brewing it more. We brewed it there around the Irish Open, actually, that was in the Hinch, which is coming up on a couple years ago now, but. Basically, we wanted something that was kind of like an approachable, alternative for some of these, for someone that was coming into one of our pubs, like a malt forward, but also kind of had that hop character as well. So this is kind of the recipe we came up with for that. It's, I think it kind of ticks those boxes. It's a nice kind of malt. It's a malt, maybe malt heavy pale, but then at the same time, kind of on the finish, you really get that Amarillo. Which is the hop that is in that. It's a really kind of nice, I find you get like a bit of a melon, almost like a melon flavor off of it. And then, you know, it's a West Coast style pale. So it's clear, it's straightforward. Like it's easy to drink, especially on like, you know, like you think of a hot day, that's the kind of beer you think of drinking. The Cliff Road is one we've been doing. It actually started off as a attempt at a wedding beer for one of the owners back about 3 years ago now. So we, at the time, were, you know, kind of reading all this stuff about New England IPAs and things like that. And we kind of just took a punt at it on the small kit, happy with the results. And then it's obviously changed the recipe itself from then to now. It's about 50%. What would be considered adjuncts, which would be oats and wheat. We have both flaked and malted oats in that, and then white wheat. And then obviously there's a small bittering hop addition with massive like whirlpool and dry hop additions on that to kind of bring out that real kind of hop burst, we call it. It's like the fruit forward, taking all that nice soft flavors and notes off the hops.
What percentages are the Hinch and Lupet?
Ooh, that's a good question. Yeah, what percentage are La Hinch and Lupet? I should know this. But
La Hinch is 4.4%, and the Cliff is 5.5%.
And your Lupet Pilsner?
Lupet is 4.5%.
Oh yeah, and just for clarity, Heineken then is 4.2. You know, so in essence, what he's saying is right. You get a bigger bang from your buck by drinking their beer, right? Now, even without the taste, just ABV wise, a bigger bang for your buck than drinking Heineken, right?
Hey, and Mike.
I'm going to say, can I go to Owen Nocton as his hand raised there for a few minutes, right? And then I'll go back to you, Hugh. Right? Owen.
Yeah, Mike. Yeah, Bridger. Yeah. First of all, I thought Bridger was actually a woman, so apologies, Bridger. I thought you were like Bridget or something like that. But apologies there. Flora and Fauna, I have to say, absolute masterstroke. Unbelievable, Deepa, for what it's worth.
Thanks very much.
I'm just drinking the the Cliff Road, and it's a small bit sour, but there's almost, even on the nose, there's a like a taste of the sea, or it's a very very earthy or very essence of the sea from it. I don't know, like, what you guys put into it, but that's what I'm getting it from.
What have you been drinking all day?
Well, I had a few of the Imperial Stouts, so yeah.
The Cliff, I don't know. We don't add anything to that now. That's out of the norm, anyway. It might, you know, it could just be, I suppose, maybe.
Oh, we're losing him. Have we lost everyone, or is just? Oh, that's us. That's us.
You leave a dry hop sitting maybe a day too long. You kind of get a lot of the earthy notes, maybe that you off the hops instead of. You know, you pull the fruity flavors into the nose and the aroma, but then you also, if you leave that dry hop a little bit too long, you might get a bit of that earthy note off some of those.
Because I mean, like a sea salt kind of taste of it, or that's the initial taste anyway. But yeah, it settled down really nice.
What did you think of the Imperial Stout anyway, Owen?
Absolute fucking banger.
Good.
Yeah,
good to hear. It was served in
a full pint glass, not one of those small glasses either. So yeah.
No.
Good.
It's for big boys and girls.
That's it. Yeah. I will say the flora and fauna is actually back now. It's on the brew schedule. I was telling someone that earlier tonight on Twitter. It's on the brew schedule. So. It's not a one and done deal. We will be brewing flora and fauna again very soon enough, actually. Probably actually re-brewing maybe at the end of June, start of July. So it'll be, you can look forward to kind of getting your hands on another few cans of that soon enough.
I was just going to say, Bridger, I didn't get the flora and fauna. I didn't. I've had it. I've tried it. I thought it was just way too much going on. That was just for me. And maybe it's just that I'm simple and simple tastes, but it's I went back a few times to try it because I was reading all the reviews and they're exceptionally good. Like, and it's for a beer of its kind to get the reviews it was getting, I couldn't believe it, right? Because it was really, really high regarded, and it just wasn't for me. And I know I said it to the lads a few times here, it just wasn't my boat. You know, I think there was just too much going on it for me personally. But, you know, and I said I did give it a good try just to try and see, was I missing something or was it just me? But, just wasn't.
There definitely is a lot going on in it. And, like, when you brew a beer like that, you kind of realize, like, it isn't going to be for everyone. So, fair enough. Like, I mean, there's 10 different hops in it, you know. For some people that might be, you know, it's a lot, but it might be a good balance. You know, they might work out. They work well together. I personally think just the way that the hop schedule between bittering, boil additions, and dry hops. But like you said, like it's when you brew a beer like that, you know, it's not going to be for everyone. So
and listen, don't get me wrong, right? Because the reviews on it were cracking, right? And that's why I went back a few times, because I was questioning myself even on this, because like I was kind of going, geez, if so many people are saying this is so good, and it just unfortunately it just wasn't for me, right? But I suppose I am really simple, because I mean I like the Cliff Road, I like the Lynch, you know, I really like tonight, but just unfortunately the flora and fauna wasn't my gig, you know. Hugh has a question. I'm gonna boom over to Hugh.
You need to put this on a stick, Mike. What I was gonna say is earlier talking about the Amarillo giving a melon finish on the beer. I got a bit of the melon flavor, but more so maybe like of the type you get in a sweet, like a chewing, like a pick a mix or something. I got it in the loop head. But that doesn't have Amarillo. It has like the Saz and the, what's the other one? And I'm just
Pearl, yeah.
Am I getting the right kind of? It's so beautiful, clean. I'm a huge fan of it. Like, I'm not a huge Pilsner man, but I'm a real big fan of the Loophead. And am I getting it right? Is it kind of like the melony flavor that you were kind of trying to push with that, the clean flavor?
Yeah, no, definitely. That's I suppose when you think of a Pilsner, obviously you're thinking of a clean flavor. I've actually heard people mention melon with the loop head. I've heard a lot of people mention even maybe a bit of small bit of honey or maybe even lemon. But yeah, like there's definitely a fruit presence on the loop head that you might not have with some of the other Pilsners that are out there, which I think kind of gives that nice, like, you know, it's one of those beers that maybe somebody who likes IPA, somebody who likes kind of these craft ales and things like that, they can sit down and drink a loop head and be happy out with it.
Good. Yeah, that loop head was a cracker, right? Yeah, the loop head is a cracker, and I suppose I wasn't surprised when you said that it was going to be probably your biggest beer, because it has, like, for me, I got it up off James from Point in Fine Wines. I had it in can. Yeah, I liked it. Like, I mean, I did, but and again, that maybe goes back to my flavor and my taste palate, kind of, because it was more straightforward. I'm not going to say simple, because simple is probably the wrong word. It knew what it was and was very well defined and very well done, you know. And I know I use the word simple sometimes, but it's not simple to get that beer right. But it was really, really good. It was a cracking beer.
Oh, thanks.
At the moment, no.
So it's one of those beers that we've struggled with walking into, like, you think about pubs, like, let's say in Clare, like, pubs, there, you can't walk in there and sell them Cliff Road or an IPA, or even Lahinch Pale Ale is a hard sell in some of these, you know, let's say West Clare pubs. But like when you look at the loop head, it's something that we could actually feel like we could walk in. That's kind of one of the reasons why I say, you know, oh, it'll be our biggest beer in a year's time. You know, we look at draft lines, and especially the local accounts that we've had over the years, like, it's something that all of them would be, you know, some of the pubs that did take us on, you know, they'd have a hard time, you know, pushing or selling to some of these, you know, traditional drinkers. Fair enough. You know, a lot of these guys go, and it's like a routine to have their Heineken or their Guinness. So it's something that we felt could bridge the gap a bit there. And kind of maybe it's a bit of a gateway beer.
Yeah. So, John McCarthy has his hand raised. Go on, John, go for it.
Okay, just can you hear me now?
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
First of all, Bridger, it's great to finally see you.
That's right, yeah. Good.
I was just going to say something about the loop head there. I would say if that went on draft into a local bar and there was people trying out new craft beer or whatever, you could automatically tell them it's like Carlsberg, but it's sweeter. And it would be a firm favorite if it was to sell next to Carlsberg. That's how I see it.
Anyway, yeah.
Stop talking. But yeah.
That's actually how, that's a lot of times, like if I'm actually describing, you know, loop head to someone who wouldn't be familiar with craft beer. I'm back. Sorry about that. My actually, the power cut here for a minute. So the Wi-Fi was gone.
We were wondering what went wrong. Okay, hang on.
Yeah, I don't know what I was just answering John's point there about the Carlsberg, but he was spot on kind of with his description of that. You know, that's kind of, I suppose, how I myself describe that a lot of times, you know, kind of our version of a Carlsberg, but it does have that nice kind of sweet finish as well. So I'm actually, give me 2 seconds there. I'm going to pull myself another pint here.
Go for it, Jay. Go for it. Yeah, we'll just wait. So I don't want to sing a song while he's gone. You know.
Come on.
We'll look in the window. We'll look in the neighbor's window and see what we can see. Hang on. It's like it kind of feels a little bit like through the doors. You remember that years ago? Through the keyhole, was it? Yeah, through the keyhole. Woo!
with Lloyd Grossman instead of Mike McMahon.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, it's a bit fun, all right. They're probably sitting above listening to us going, what the hell is going on? So for everyone listening to the podcast, we're sitting on the road, right, in the lane beside the pub, doing Meet the Brewer on the TV, and it's all a bit mad, right, because there's random people walking past us. They're all waving at the camera. It's great. They don't know what's going on. We've randomers here who didn't even know that we're going to be involved in this, right? They don't know what's going on, right? But so it's all... it's all a bit of good crack, right? And I mean, it's a bit, and you got a beer out of it, right? Because you, so the lads on my left, let's go from left to right. The lads on my left are going to try the Le Hinch. I do notice, Bridger, you spelt Le Hinch with an A, not an E. Was that purposeful?
Do you know, I was actually thinking about that the other day with the way it just, when I was unpacking the cans there, I was thinking, or, you know, and then writing the name on the boxes, like, but it wasn't purposeful anyway. It, you know, every other sign you go by, it's spelled different. So we just went with the one that we, I suppose, that we have in our own pub is with an A. So yeah, that's why we went with that.
Yeah, the official place is spelled with an E.
Is that the official way? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Because if you drive, right, if you drive off the motorway and go on the Ennis bypass, right, you'll actually see that people have gone around and scribbled out the E and put an A in, because there's a big anti E movement in West Clare, yeah, when it comes to Le Hinch, because it's LA, not LE.
That's right. Yeah, no, I like you said, I've seen the signs where someone's gone on and put their own sticker on the E, or, you know, an E over the A.
So Barry's after making a very good commentary, and I think you should steal it from him, right? You know, he said you should do a limited edition batch with the E on it, just for the crack.
Just mix in like half the cans. We'll mix in half the cans.
Yeah, Laurie's asking which tastes better, the A or the E. Yeah, that's the taste.
Okay. Well, I should get up a bunch of stickers. Get a bunch of stickers made up the next time and just stick an E over it.
I think you know, I'm looking at the guys here, because they're here now and they're trying the stout, right? Everyone stare at them, right? Everyone just stare at them as they're doing it. They're looking good. Good health, right? So in fairness, like, two lads are on Beamish, right? And what I love, right? And to be honest, I don't care whether someone likes craft beer or not. I don't care whether they try it, or, well, I don't care whether they constantly drink it or not. Once they're willing to give it a try, I'm quite happy, right? Because, you know, just been closed and not wanting to try it is a very bad way to be in life. So, I mean, fair dues, you're trying it, right? It's 9.5%, so take it easy. Yeah, there's no problem, right? And then on this side, right, we've given the lads some hints. They're avid Heineken drinkers. And we've given them the Le Hinch to try, right? Just because we had a customer in last night who normally would drink Heineken, and asked us what would he have instead. And I defaulted to Scraggy Bay because it's one that I know that most people would like. And I think last night we converted him to artisan beer, or just small batch independent beer, because he really liked it. And I mean, the flavor speaks for itself, right? So we'll see how the four lads get on, right? And just as we look around, right, we've got two more Imperial Stout drinkers. We definitely have, oh, it's a Trina Hinch. Yeah, we've three. What do you think of the stout? Unreal is a comment coming back here. Hang on 1 minute. 1 minute. She loves stout. Let's talk.
I love stout, but I don't always like craft stout. And that is savage. That is so good.
I think that's a compliment that we can't accept.
Oh, good.
No. Okay, look, I'm going to open up the questions, right? Because I'm just conscious that, right, as I'm sitting here, my unfortunate staff are actually working twice as hard, right? Because I'm just I'm just hanging around, getting to drink beer and talk to you, right? So I'm just conscious of my time, and I'm conscious of the time of the staff, because they've been good enough to allow us to do this, right? So is there any questions from the guys online? Any questions here in the room as well, or here in the street, on the road?
Rob has a question there.
Go, Rob. I was awful worried. I was awful worried today, right? Cause, like, I said we'd do this, right? And I didn't really give it much thought. And here we are. Like, we just rolled the TV out. We just said, we pulled an extension cord through the window, and we're just rocking and rolling. I wasn't even sure if we'd Wi-Fi here in the lane, to be honest. Yeah. You mind? Yeah. We've tapped in, yeah. You know, oh, Lord, as we sit here. Okay, Rob, are you...
Brewery.
Would you run a brewery?
No, a brewery fucking course.
Course. Would you run a home? Would you run a homebrew course? Is the question.
Yeah. We've actually we're big fans of homebrew at Western Herd. Like, we We would, if you'd be interested in learning, like, we'd definitely give you a hand with that. We're actually in the process of setting up on our website a kind of a homebrew section with, you know, links to good kits that you can get from Gitter Brewed, recipes, even basic, simple recipes to get going. We have a homebrew contest every year, which is actually coming up. We get entries in from all over Ireland and the UK. Last year, we got an entry from Australia as well. We kind of just picked the homebrew winner, homebrew beer of the year. Last year, it was the Saison from Niall Clinton out in Westmeath. But if you're interested in homebrew, that's something that we think is great. And, you know, any way that we can help out with that, we'd be happy to help out.
That Saison was an absolute cracker. You know, it was really, really, really good. Like, is that something you're going to bring out again, or is you just going to kill it off with as part of the homebrew?
We've brewed a couple of the homebrews now, homebrew winners. We've brewed a second or third time, so I could definitely see us at some stage brewing that again. It was a really good beer, just a really crushable saison. So, I definitely would say, you know, we'd be up for brewing that one again.
Okay. So any other, okay, sorry, Rob, I'm going to read out just on the stout. So Rob is asking, just on the stout, the difference between this one and what the W.D. O'Connell one will be. I think, did you mention the W.D. O'Connell is going into a peated barrel, I think, was it?
So Rob actually tried this Imperial Stout on a W.D. O'Connell tasting there a few weeks ago. It was actually the unaged version of this stout. So then basically think this stout spent, time finishing in a cognac cask from Domingate. It's a separate cask, but it is the same beer that I have in a separate cask from W. O'Connell. Now that one's not the peated one. That one's for the barley wine, it's the peated one, but it's a double distilled Irish whiskey that I have a cask from. For the W.D. O'Connell. So it is interesting, like, the difference between the two now at this point, between the cognac cask and the double distilled. Like, the double distilled one, just straight pungent Irish whiskey off it as soon as you pop the cork in the barrel. Like, it's just like a real, like, you think of like kind of what that single malt classic, like, Irish whiskey. That's first thing you get on the nose. The one from Thomond, I find you have a bit more. It is that cognac cask, so it has kind of that, you know, nice brandy kind of sweet finish that a lot of people are talking about, like that chocolate and vanilla. So it is because that's kind of one of the things I was interested in this with too, because you can see the two different ways that it would be influenced by the cast. So I'm happy with both. They're both different. It's the same beer gone into both casts, but they both came out different. They're both excellent in my biased opinion.
So I've the two lads here beside me, right? And they're very complimentary of the Lahinch, right? They're really enjoying it, right? And Donal has 16 years. He's been bar work a long time, right? Now he's out of it at the moment, but I know people trying to court him back in because he's just as good at what he does, right? But he asked a very good question there, right? Why are people afraid of cloudy beer? You know, the general beer drinker, right? Now, and I'm not going to say craft beer because we're all kind of, yeah, because just across the board. But I know there's a whole movement towards New England IPAs, juice bombs, all that kind of stuff. The cloudier beers are really coming in, right? Yeah. But it's a very fair question. If you were to hand a pint of cloudy beer up in front of someone in a non-craft in a bar,
not normal,
they would be afraid of it. Why is that? Why do you think, Bridger?
I'd say it's just what, you know, probably what people are used to. Like, you know, you think of the Heineken drinker, they're used to, you know, the big foamy head and a crystal clear pint. Like, I say it's just what people are. It's the same thing. When we switched to cans, we had loads of restaurants and hotels that we used to stock bottles with that were instantly repelled by the thought of a can.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's like, to me, it's the same kind of just traditional, you know, thinking. You know, it's like, this is what it always was. This is what it always should be. I'd say it's nearly like, that's probably just what it comes down to.
It's, Mike, it's changing the mindset. Because down in Dingle, they had the coffee stout. And I think that was 6 or maybe 5.5%. And it was a pure coffee taste, but like it was such a smooth stout. And like it would be like equitable to Beamish in terms of the smoothness, but
you're seriously on a retainer from Dingle, like Dick Mack.
Yeah, I definitely am.
Our Dingle tourism paying you to talk here, because like that, every that meet, or every whiplash. Meet tomorrow, it's Dingle, right?
No, that or whiplash.
No, that's a whiplash. Yeah. No, I mean, look, we almost in earlier on today, right? We had a conversation about stouts, right? And imperial stouts. And Owen's dad, I hope you don't mind me saying this one, right? Owen's dad said the head has gone off it really quickly, right?
Mm, yeah.
And almost kind of saying to me quietly, he was saying the head has gone off it really quickly. And we chuckled, but we kind of went, geez, it was lucky to have a head at all, you know, because of the style of beer it is, it's not conducive to having that creamy top that you expect from a Guinness or a Beamish. It's just not that type of beer, right? So I suppose it comes back then to maybe Donald's question, perception of and anticipation of what we're getting. You know, when we call a pint of lager, we expect it to be crisp, clean.
And it's marketing.
I'm
going
to say clear, right? Translucent, beautiful color, right? And you can see right through it. Whereas if there's any bit of cloudiness in there or any bit of darkness in there, we see it as being a fault with it, right? And maybe it's just how we've been brought up.
It's just marketing, like.
Yeah, generally, yeah, you're right. It is, right?
Yeah.
Just you as a question here.
Hi, Bridger. You're going to maybe enjoy answering this, but you spoke earlier about Montana and the brewing culture there. We've all heard about kind of the West Coast style and the East Coast style. First part of the question is, what is Montana style? And the second part is, how does it influence what you do with Western Herd? You know, because I think it has its own thing. You know, I think Western Herd has its own thing going on. And is that Montana style coming through? So what is that? What do you think? What's the influence from Montana?
Yeah, the influence from Montana is definitely I grew up with the idea that, you know, I was a big hophead. You know, once I started getting into craft beer, it was all about the hops, all about the IPAs, double IPAs, like West Coast style. Obviously that was, I suppose, for anybody in craft, everybody probably went through that time, that kind of a phase. But like, to be honest, like you think of like the New England IPAs and you think of the West Coast IPAs, there's actually a kind of a subgenre in the middle there, and they call it a Rocky Mountain IPA. And if you look, actually, if you Google that, like a Rocky Mountain IPA is just nearly like kind of a like a dry, almost like a dry New England, filtered, not cleared, but I mean, it doesn't look like orange juice. It doesn't look like you know, it's not that really kind of. It doesn't look like somebody dumped a bunch of flour in it. It's kind of got nearly a bit of both, let's say. Rocky Mountain is kind of, I suppose, the bridge between the two. So I feel like some of our beers even have that style, like, you know, like even our West Coast big IPAs, you know, a lot of the hop additions we use are almost the New England style hop addition, like in the Lahinch Pale, you know, we had a big Whirlpool addition, which, you know, typically wouldn't be in some of the bigger West Coast Pales, West Coast IPAs. Even our Blue Jumper, which is kind of our flagship West Coast IPA. I mean, there's massive, like there's not much for boil additions at all in that, which, you know, for West Coast IPAs, you know, West Coast IPAs kind of have that textbook bitter backbone from the boil addition hops. So I suppose that's kind of maybe the style of Montana brewing is kind of, you know, taken a bit from both sides. And I can definitely say we do that from we do that in Western Herd a bit, you know, depending on obviously the beer, but we definitely do that.
So just John,
try to anyway.
John Noel, you want to unmute yourself and go for it, John?
Sure. Thank you. I have a comment and then a question. This Imperial Stout is amazing. I kind of expected that though. But what I'm finding is that I'm also drinking the pale ale, and over the course of this session, it seems to be opening up and becoming more complex, which it's fantastic. I really, really like it. So my question is, following up on the IPA West Coast versus East Coast, I sometimes feel like especially the West Coast IPAs, it's a bit like who can eat the hottest curry, you know? How much hops can we get away with? How bitter can we make this and people still drink it? Is this a fad that may fade towards more nuanced brewing, or is it something that's here to stay, in your opinion?
I think in my opinion, like, that you're spot on with that. It was I'd say it was an arms race there for hop use. I mean, it was, I don't know, you probably remember yourself, like, it was nearly like the same size on a bottle or a can, like, as an ABV, like the IBUs that were in a beer, which is International Bitterness Units. But you know, it was definitely like that. And I kind of, if I walk into a new brewery that I've never been to, like I said earlier, like, I'm a hop head. I love a hoppy beer. I love even the bitter beers. But the first beer that I'm going to order off the menu is a pale ale, because in my opinion, like, you can make a good beer and have the hops balance it. You can, a lot of breweries, in my opinion anyway, make an all right beer or a subpar beer, and they kind of bury whatever the beer is in hops, and you know, they get away with it because, like, let's face it, like, hops are good. Hops are what make a lot of these beers. But I just think it's easy to make nearly, like, it's easy to make a bad beer and dump a bunch of hops in it, and people will like it and people will still drink it, and fair enough, like, I drink it, I'll be honest. But at the same time, then, if you can make a good pale ale that kind of has, like, that malty backbone, like, that, I think that says a lot about a brewery. I don't know how many breweries I walked into in the States where it's like, I go to order the pale and it's like, they say, oh, you like the pale ale, it's more hoppy than even the IPA. And it's like, you'd wonder, like, okay, well, that's because it's probably not a great beer at the base of it. I think we are, I feel like we are kind of pulling out of that though. Like, even in the craft industry in Ireland, like, you're starting to see a lot more, like, pilsners and, you know, even back to, like, you know, brown ales or red ales, like, those are beers that you have to kind of build from the ground up. Like, they're, like, you have to build it from the malt, you know, the malt bill down to the hop bill down to the, you know, the fermentation. Everything has to be spot on with those beers. You can't just bury it in a bunch of hops and think it'll be grand.
Sorry, our neighbors are just passing there. They look quite unimpressed.
We're having a session in the front
window. We're going into it. Okay, look. Any other questions, right? Because, like, I'm going to say, right, the two boys beside me here are quite impressed with the hinge, right? They're I think they're almost swung towards it. How are we finding?
Lovely. Very nice. It's gorgeous, but it's very much a engine light drink. I don't think you'd start off very sweet.
That's a very sensible thing to say, because it is 9.5%. It would. It's really chocolatey. It's lovely. It's a lovely whiskey kick off. Right. That is liquid dessert. I think is probably the best compliment you can give us. Right. You know. So I'm actually going to say, right, left and right of me. Right. So I sat in the middle. They weren't here for Meet the Brewer. They were just here. Right. And they've joined in. And I want to say thanks. Right. Because you know what? You've been good fun. Right. You've let us intrude on your evening a little bit. Right. Right.
You got a drink
because we've intruded on your evening a little bit. Right. And there's nothing worse than going out and having someone intrude on your evening. Right. And then start asking you questions. And You know, but look, okay, great. Has anyone got any other questions? Because I am going to wind it up, right? Because
no, Mike, I think I got my microphone working. I Hang changed on,
Rob,
to my phone.
There's Rob. There's hello, Rob. Go first.
How are you? How's it going?
Rob, how's things, Rob?
Yeah. How are you doing there, Bridger? Yeah, I was very interested in the difference between the two stouts, having the WG one and this one. And you can definitely, you know, you can get that cask from it. But like John there earlier, it's kind of like a compliment and a question in the same thing, because there's some great beers coming out there. And also, nobody's mentioned your artwork has just taken a massive leap forward with like the loop head. Ken was just fantastic. And even the La Hinge Pale, I think, is a fantastic artwork. And the flora and fauna. So who's doing your artwork? It's really taken a step up.
Yeah, no, I agree with you there, definitely. So it's actually, like, for those of you that don't know, our labels for the first 4 or 5 years, they were all basically outlines of the Clare coastline, which was a good base to start from for a lot of our beers. Actually, the first kind of stray away from that we would have done would have been probably the Dolman. And then a couple of years ago for the Irish Open, we did the La Hinge Pale Ale. And we did a mock-up with cans and then tap badges for that. That basically was, you know, kind of straight off of, you know, kind of what we were used to at the time. So it's actually, they basically, one of the owners, Michael Eustace is the one of the owners there. His brother-in-law owns Brandish Designs. So he's a graphic designer there in Dublin. So he's basically, he did all the coastline labels as well, but we've kind of given him free reign basically the last, you know, few brews, starting with the La Hinch and then going on to Loop Head, going on to Flora and Fauna, LPA. He did the LPA, of course, but we're kind of just, we went from saying, and you know, we will still do the beers that are obviously very Clare based, Clare, you know, Clare coastline, but then we've kind of just opened it up to him and given him his kind of free artistic reign on what he thinks would look good on a can. And like at this stage, like he's proven himself, like we're just going to keep going with that. We've got a new IPA that's getting canned at the end of June here. It's all New Zealand hops. One of them's brand new. First, as far as I know, it's the first beer in Ireland to use it. It's called Nectaron. It was just named there a couple of months ago. It used to be called HORT 4337, I think it was. But it's Nectaron. We're going to have Nectaron, Nelson Sauvin, Reiku, and Kohatu in that. And it's going to have kind of a off the beaten path label on it as well. And I know the name of it. I actually can't even pronounce it myself. It's going to be one of those beers. It's basically on the opposite side of the world from where we are in Ireland. It's a small island off the coast of New Zealand. And so that's what we're naming it after, is that island. And I'll show you, I'll pull it up on my phone here. You guys will be the first to have a look at this label. So this is the new label here.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
So that's the island there, the Motu Ihupuku. So it'll be one of those beers I will be saying, we don't know how to pronounce it, but you should try it. But anyway, that's the kind of the story behind it is, on the opposite side of the world, let's say the exact opposite side, as far away as you can get, is an island off the coast of New Zealand. All these hops are from New Zealand that we're using in this beer. It's shaping up to be a cracker.
We've been photobombed here. Look at this. Look at this rogue. Look who's after. Look, Canine, right? You heard you were on, Steve Canine. Heard you were on, and is after just rocking in, right? Yeah, not gonna
How's
go.
Things, Steve?
Yeah. So, right. So he's going to start. He's going to start with now. Normally, you know, my people's people, right? But look, sure. Yeah, no, they can't see us, Steve. Go wait. We're going to meet the brewer. Yeah, we're here going to meet the. Oh, good God! Right, he's here. He's here. Right?
Hey, Mike, has Steve any more stories for us?
Steve is gone.
Nah.
Is my name my Saturday night name is Jacinta. He's off. Go away. Okay, Bridger, sorry to cut across you, right? But there he was leering over our shoulders, right? You know, wondering what's going on, right? You know, and I do believe he was taking photographs of your new canning label. You know, so I do apologize. Right? The secret is out. So I hope to God you've trademarked this.
Secret's out.
Okay, look, on that note, right, look, I'm going to say a huge, huge thank you to everyone who joined us here, right, those who intended to join us, those who kind of accidentally found their way in, right, even better, right, those that have joined us online, getting growlers, you know, thank you very much, because without all of you, we wouldn't be buying the beer, we definitely wouldn't be here in the laneway today, Bridger wouldn't be there making the beer either, right, so it's a huge thank you to all of you, and at that, right, from the most unusual Meet the Brewer we have done so far, right?
In a row.
Most unusual, right? The last one we did was live from Treaty City Brewery. This is live from Back Lane, Limerick City, right? And in front of our neighbor's bedroom's window, right? you know, it's just lunacy, right? So I just want to say, Bridger, thank you to yourself and all the guys and girls in Western Heart for making this possible. You know, we've really enjoyed it, okay? And on that, have a very good night.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks to everybody there for trying the beers, and thanks for the support. So it's been it's good to be here. Thanks for doing this, Michael. It's great to have a pub in you know, this side of the country that's supportive, and you know, you guys keep doing what you guys are doing.
And I should note, just for fairness and balance, Mahogans do pour their beer also. They're good supporters as well. I can't remember what they have on draft. Actually, they have what have they on draft for me at the moment?
Islander,
purple,
yeah.
Islander, the purple label, yeah. That's right.
Islander.
Yeah.
Which and then so the Lahinch is actually then down at Crew Brewing as well.
Yeah.
The Lahinch at the moment.
So there you go, yep. Right? Crew Brew have Lahinch. Mahogans have Islander. We have the beautiful, beautiful one-off keg of
Cheers
the stout.
Which is
mine. You know, we also have the Lahinch as well, right? So just so you know, right, where it really goes on, right? Okay, on that note, I'm going to leave it because they're calling in my ear going, are you finished yet? Come on, get back to work, right? So on that note, thank you very much. Enjoyed the night. Bridger, thank you. Thanks everyone online. Thanks everyone here. Have a good night. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys.
So we've come to the end of Meet the Brewer, and probably one of the most unusual Meet the Brewers that we've done. As you can tell, Mike, i.e. me, was exceptionally giddy to be sitting with amongst a group of our good regulars and good friends and customers, you know, and it was probably the first time since September that we've been able to gather together in a safe manner, albeit sitting on Back Lane, and enjoy beer, enjoy a bit of crack, and talk to Bridger from Western Heart. I just want to say a huge thank you to everyone that joined us. Huge, huge thank you to Bridger. I know there's some technical difficulties through us, but you know, I hope you appreciate the fact that this was done on a laneway. Again, thanks to everyone who bought the beer. Thanks to everyone who supported. And look forward to the next one.